Hey guys, this is No Gym Needed Radio number 3, and the main theme today is how my bench press went from 115 pounds to over 300. So we're going to get into that. I wanted to tie up a couple loose ends from the last radio show. I said I lumped creatine together with amino acids. I said it was made by gathering hair from Chinese hair salons. I don't think that's how creatine is made. Creatine is also artificially made in a laboratory with some sketchy things. But that's specifically the branched chain amino acids that are made from the Chinese hair. So I wanted to mention a couple other things. We were talking about bogus products, and Andrew actually had a couple that he was using. It was horny goat weed. Can you relate your experience with that? A lot of people are getting that, thinking it's going to do something for them.
Horny goat weed, for me, didn't increase my libido at all, which is supposed to be its main effect. And to my knowledge, from a plant that goats were eating before mating season. So that should tell you right there that it's probably not going to be very effective on humans. You know, goats and dogs and different animals are going to mate at a much different rate than we do. But that aside, I tried using it to increase my libido. For reasons that that's no need to explain on this channel, but it didn't do that at all, and there's side effects if you take too much of it. So I forget what the adverse side effects were exactly right now, because it's been so long since I've taken it, but there's some serious side effects if you take way too much of it.
Bruh, I seen some rabbits eating my grass in my front yard, and then like within a week there was like 50 rabbits in my front yard. Should we call that horny rabbit grass weed? I guarantee you boost testosterone.
Yeah, definitely.
So yeah, I think that's it for the last broadcast. So how did my bench press go from 115 pounds to over 300? Well, it was a really slow process, and at first, I can't do a left turn here. I'm driving home, guys. At first, I had 115 pounds on the bar, and it was really heavy for me when I began my workout journey. And so I would do a lot of, dumbbell bench press. Because when you're doing dumbbell bench press, you have to use a lot of stabilizer muscles in your shoulder and in your chest, more so than when you're doing it with the barbell. So that'll help you get your shoulders and your chest. It'll help with greater muscle density, and you won't be really lacking anything when you go and do the barbell. So I got to a point where I could do 10 reps with 115 pounds. And at that point, I think I was doing it like every day. And I was just trying to do 10 reps with that every single day until I could master it. And then I specifically started doing really intense chest workouts. I was running myself into the ground. I was going until I couldn't even do reps with the bar. And I think that might have been too much, but I was a skinny guy trying to put on muscle, so I needed that kind of stimulation as well as high calories. And for a long time, my bench press was very, very stunted. It was at, I'd say about, 150, 165. Okay, and then Andrew here, he always had a heavier bench press than me because he had been bench pressing about twice a week since he was in high school. And I didn't even start working out till after I graduated high school, or actually senior year. So first I got some tips from Andrew and I utilized some of them. So first and foremost, how did you get your bench press up? And what things have you what techniques have you used over the years that worked, and what techniques have you dropped because they weren't doing anything?
I first started with just the 45 plates way back in high school. And then I started just slowly moving up because it just felt too easy. And it always felt too easy. But it's hard when you're first starting to push yourself, because it's hard to feel what pushing yourself to the limit is when you've never done that before. So, and I slowly moved up. I don't remember exactly what weights I was at what age, but I remember learning pyramiding my weights when I was a senior in high school. Randomly, one day I worked out during my lunch break.
I'll tell someone what a pyramid is in case they're not sure, or maybe they've heard there's different kinds of pyramids.
Yeah, so pyramiding would be just simply adding, it could be a small portion of weight, just fives on each end, which would be a total of 10 pounds. It's just adding 10 pounds to each set so that each set gets heavier as you are progressing through your workout.
But so do you utilize the rep range theory, where generally 8 to 12 reps will produce the most hypertrophy for the biggest muscle gains, and do you incorporate that into your pyramid?
Yes.
So as far as reps and sets, what does it look like? No, wait, just reps and sets.
Reps would be 12 reps, 10 reps, 8 reps, and 12, 10, and 8, 3 reps. And that's so, excluding a warm-up and cool-down.
And the 12, 10, and 8, it's basically like you can only do 12 right there, right? And you can only do 10, and you can only do 8.
Yes.
The weight should be about that much.
Yes, that's the goal.
All right.
And it should be so heavy that that's the goal you're trying to reach. You may not even get there.
Right.
Most of the time, I actually don't fulfill my rep goal of my workout.
All right, so go ahead. You were talking about in high school.
Yeah, so I worked out actually with... I was in some special ed classes when my vision went south in high school. And so there was one former student of mine, or one peer of mine, who was severely mentally challenged. And he had an aide with him everywhere he went. Now, this particular aide was 25 or so. I don't know exactly how old he was. He was in college still, but he was an aide of the class, and he wanted to work out during the lunch period, and I went with him, and he strongly recommended that I pyramid and that I would not get stronger if I didn't. And I believed him because he was stronger than I was at the time. That's when I started doing that. At a pretty young age, 17 years old. Before that, I was working out pretty hard, but didn't really know how to push it to the level that I needed to be.
You were training, but not logistically, intuitively, right?
Right.
Yeah. And yeah, I trained intuitively for many, many years, and I had such good results in the beginning. I thought that's all I needed. Almost missed the exit there, but eventually when my bench wasn't going up anymore, I knew I had to do something different, and I started training logistically, and that was the key to getting my bench press up. So what is your current pyramid, and what is your recent max that you've tried to hit?
I'm at a pyramid of 235 pounds to 255. I hit, what is it? I believe it was 305, two reps, a two rep max of 305 a couple months ago, I think, 3 months ago. It's hard to do a one rep max when you work out by yourself most days, but that's pretty much all of my weight that I own at the time, and I as well do not attend a gym, so I can't go and test higher limits there. But that's my current pyramid, 235 to 255. on a good day.
What's your recent max?
305, 2 rep max.
Nice. And I as well have recently been able to do 305, and I'll get into the details of that as well. And so, I told Andrew, look, I always do strange chest workouts and stuff, and I'm always using unique things, so my bench press isn't where I think it should be, so I'm like, give me 3 months and I'll become as strong as you in the bench press. So I went to Canada for an entire month and got this crazy gym pass. I have a vlog on that if you guys want to go watch it, but I trained for a month there and then I trained 2 months more in a row. And my bench press, literally, I don't even know if it went up. It was at like, I don't even know, maybe not even 200 pounds, around 200 pounds. And I don't think it went up that whole time. And I was like, what am I doing wrong? I was still training intuitively, more or less. I was trying to do more bench press, obviously. And then I basically kept saying the same thing, give me 3 months, give me 3 months. And then I started watching Nick Wright, teen bodybuilder or whatever. I don't know if he's a teen anymore, but just specifically his videos on how he got his bench press up. And he talked about doing half reps where he would lay on the ground so your elbows can only go to a 90 degree angle, and then also doing pause reps. And then I guess Vegan Gains was advocating pause reps as well, and he has a pretty heavy bench press. And Nick Wright is short like Andrew, so he doesn't have to, when he goes down and touches his chest, his elbows are only going to about a 90 degree angle anyway, which makes it a lot easier for them to get it back up off their chest. However, someone like me who's 6'3", I related more to Vegan Gains because he's 6'3 as well. And so when he touches his chest on a bench press, his elbows are like way down. You know, we're at like a, I don't know, 145 degree angle or something. So we don't have as much leverage to get it back up. So he was talking about pause reps and how that helped him. And Nick Wright also brought that out as well. So I started doing those and just, I wasn't really counting reps, I was just doing the best I could, and my bench press slowly went up, and it went up, and it went up, and I think I was doing 215, fairly easy, and I was stoked on that. Then I started figuring out that when I was doing overhead press on my bar, and I was barely able to do 115 pounds, and it was really hard, and then I was doing that for many weeks, and then I went to Andrew's house, and he had the 135, the 45-pound plates on the side of a 45-pound Olympic bar. And then I started doing reps on his, and it felt a little bit easier than my 115 at my house. And I was like, what's going on here? And then I started thinking about it, and I have a 15-pound bar compared to his 45-pound bar, and I have 50-pound plates instead of his 45-pound plates. He has 3 even weights going across all of it. I have 2 really heavy weights and 1 extremely light weight on a skinny bar. And I started doing the physics and looking at the geometry of all that. And it seems that basically my bar is the key to making my weights feel totally different. And in some cases heavier and harder. But I don't think it's like that on my bench press. My bench press seems to be pretty good and leveled out. So it does play a little factor though. And anyways, then I saw something about a slingshot, and it's this thing you put on your elbows, and really it doesn't work for short people because you have to go beyond a 90 degree angle to get the recoil of the slingshot. And so it really gives tall people the advantage that short people have on the bench press. And as soon as I got that and I started taking some creatine again, creatine, it increases the, what is called, DHT, testosterone production, so it could add to male pattern baldness. So I didn't take it for a long time because I was worried about that, but that's more of a genetic thing. So anyways, I started taking creatine and I combined it with this slingshot, and my bench press, probably within 3 months, went from 215-ish all the way up to 300. And then I was able to keep up with Andrew. I jumped right into his pyramid set. I was able to do his pyramid set. And yeah, it was nothing short of a miracle. And so now I use the slingshot, but I also do regular reps, and my regular reps are getting closer to my slingshot reps, but it'll easily add 15% more to a tall guy's bench press, and it'll help you work on your form, and it'll help your body feel that it can actually handle that weight. So that is the key for me. Creatine helps a little bit with the ATP in your muscles and also in your brain. And then the slingshot is really a tall man's secret weapon for the bench press. I suggest everyone go and get it if they're tall, if they have long arms, and they're having trouble with their bench press. So that was my secret. So on my workout videos, I've got criticisms about my form on squats and my form on curls. The curl one is easier to address, so I'll address that first. Some guy was saying, this is the second video I've watched now and your form is appalling. You need to curl and go all the way down. Okay, so, first of all, my arms are probably way bigger than that guy's anyway. And secondly, being tall like me, sometimes going all the way down with heavy weight can really put stress on your tendons a little bit more than other people. And then my reply to that guy was a video by Cedric McMillan. Cedric McMillan is a world-class bodybuilder. His recent biggest win was the Arnold Classic, I think Ohio. And he's on the Olympia stage every single year. Well, he has a vlog where he's talking about that when he did curls going all the way down, he would get this pain in between his forearm and his bicep, and right on the bottom of his bicep. And he thinks it's from being tall and from using really heavy weight. And I agree with that. I felt that pain as well. And so he advocates going 3/4 of the way down if you're 6 foot or over and you're getting that pain. And he says you'll get a better pump, and that's all he does. And he also brings out the point where, you know, or I don't know if he brings out this point or not, but it's obvious. If you're going 3/4 of the way down, or you're just not going all the way down, your muscles are always having time under tension. And time under tension is directly correlated to hypertrophy and muscle growth. When you're going all the way down, you're just bouncing the weight off your tendons, more or less, in your joints. And there's a point where all the weight comes off of your muscles and goes right onto your tendons and joints. So I don't know why the guy is so adamant on that. And so my reply to him was the Cedric McMillan video. You guys can go check that out if you want. Secondly, my squats. In the videos, I was doing really micro-repped squats. And the weight was pretty heavy. It was like 350 to 400 range. And the reason for that is because, well, first of all, I can't go all the way down with that much weight. However, I can definitely walk around with that much weight and do micro reps with that much weight. And when I started doing that, just to see where I needed to be, my quads really responded to that. They blew up and they had some sick definition and stuff. And it worked for me. And then I was reading a manga actually, a sports manga, Kuroko no Basket. And it was talking about fartlek training. And that's a real concept that Swedish people and Finland people use for their professional sports teams, where you build muscle in a gym, and then you go run through a forest or on the side of a mountain to create functionality in your muscles. And it has a very good carryover effect from the gym to the sport you're playing. So what I was doing is, look, you walk around all day, and your legs become fairly strong because of that. It's obvious common sense that if you walk around with 400 pounds on your back, you're going to become stronger in your muscles and your joints. And one time I hurt my ankle, and the way I fixed it and got it stronger was by just basically walking on unlevel surfaces often, and it got a lot stronger. So I'm walking around my backyard with all this weight on me, and it's really hard. But it also gives me a great workout and strengthens my joints and gives me a good muscle pump. And then when I'm doing really lightweight, yeah, I'm squatting all the way down if it's pretty light, because I don't want to put all the stress on my joints like I spoke about before and end up like Ronnie Coleman. You guys don't want to see that kind of stuff. Who wants to see me squat super lightweight? Nobody wants to see that, so I don't film it. So what you saw was me doing my micro reps and fartlek. And that's a unique form of training that a lot of people don't know, and maybe it'll work for you, maybe it won't. And I explained that in the latter part of the video, but he obviously didn't watch that far. a lot of people, they don't want an explanation. They just want to criticize you. And it's most likely because they themselves are having trouble getting gains. And, you know, they don't want to admit it, but they think they're doing everything right, and they think their gains are so hard to come by. They can't stand seeing someone doing something else that they don't understand, and they don't even try to understand it. They just want to criticize you because they've been fit into a mold. But when it comes down to it, I had a method to my madness. It works for me. I got big quads, defined quads, and big arms, and yeah. That guy is just going on YouTube criticizing people. I'm creating content and having a great time doing it. So, you guys can choose what you want, and not everything work. Not things that work for me might not work for you. Perfect form is good to build. You really need to build that before you try anything strange or out of the ordinary. I agree with that. All right, guys, now we're gonna do a lightning round what if. I'm gonna give Andrew the what if. What if Krillin was a Saiyan? And the premise here is, after the Dragon Ball series, the original one, Goku and Krillin go their own ways, and Krillin's training, and he doesn't even get as strong as Goku was before they parted ways, and he's starting to think something is strange. So Krillin summons Shenron. He asks Shenron, what's Goku's secret? Why is he so strong? Shenron says he's a Saiyan. He's from a different planet. That planet has heavier gravity. They're warriors. They can get much stronger in humans. So then Krillin is like, whoa, he can't stop thinking about that. So he gathers the Dragon Balls again eventually, summons Shenron, and says, I want to be a Saiyan. Make me a Saiyan. And so Krillin gets Saiyan DNA. So this is, what if Krillin was a Saiyan? And we're going to start from the beginning of the Dragon Ball Z saga.
Well, Krillin, with his newfound power, now knows that he can go toe-to-toe with Goku. At least he thinks that, because he's trained just as long as Goku has. Not under the same guidances as Goku has met with Kami and had adventure of his own to get him to the point he's got to. But Krillin is gonna feel like he's at Goku's level again, as they were at one time.
He trained, obviously, from the time he made that wish to Dragon Ball Z.
Oh, definitely.
As a Saiyan.
Krillin's always been training. If you remember, at the end of the Dragon Ball series, he was in the World Tournament, and he fought with Chiaotzu, was his last battle. So if we were to fast forward the time here, Krillin isn't going to want to fight and kill his friend Goku, no. He's going to want to go toe-to-toe with the guys who beat him out before.
Oh, true.
So he's going to go after Tien, Chiaotzu, and Piccolo, and challenge them himself. Piccolo, of course, being the guy who ultimately wants to kill Goku, but can't at the time. Tien and Chiaotzu just being stronger rivals. So Krillin finds Tien and Chiaotzu first and challenges them to a fight.
It's not unfair either, because Tien is like part alien. He's from the Third Eye Tribe or whatever.
Yeah. So Krillin is going to start with Chiaotzu. Chiaotzu, of course, thinks that he's superior to Krillin because he beat him with these before. Of course, these guys don't have any bad blood anymore, so this fight isn't to the death, really. Krillin just wants to show off that he can go toe-to-toe with these guys now. So Krillin ultimately gets the better end of Chiaotzu very quickly. In their first fight, all Chiaotzu did to beat him was fly in the air and blast him with Dodon rays. Krillin couldn't even fly at the time, so he was supremely outmatched here. Of course, now that he's a Saiyan, flying just comes naturally. With all the training he's had with Ki, it's very easy for him to accomplish. So Krillin is able to fly and just straight up wail on Chiaotzu. And his Dodon Ray has no effect on the power of the Kamehameha Wave that Krillin can produce, along with his destructive disc and all the other techniques he's learned. So then, After Chao Tzu gets a pretty good beating, Tien refuses to fight Krillin. Tien doesn't want to go toe-to-toe with Krillin, but he knows that something supernatural has occurred here. He can see right through it with his third eye and everything. So, Tien says to Krillin, "What the heck's gotten into you, Krillin? There's something different about you." And then Krillin thinks to himself, "Oh man, I don't know if I should tell these guys of the wish I just made. That would kind of make me seem like a loser. I'll just push it under the rug for now." That's what a lot of training does for you, Tien. Yeah, maybe you should start training more, I guess. Of course, Tien doesn't believe this, but he plays along with it. Whatever, Krillin. Keep training, I guess. I'm not gonna fight you, though. I don't want things to get out of hand. You're obviously way stronger than you were before, and I don't want to test your limits right now. Krillin is surprised at Tien's reply. So then he thinks to himself, "Well, I guess there's only Piccolo to go after from here." I don't know how long you're supposed to go on with this, because
you're supposed to go all the way through Dragon Ball Z, y'all.
All the way through.
You haven't even got to Raditz yet.
I suppose Raditz could interfere at this point.
Yeah, this is right when Raditz is coming by Piccolo.
Yeah, that would be a good part. Raditz comes by Piccolo. Raditz is looking for Goku, obviously, and runs into Piccolo because Piccolo's strong. So then, when he gets rid of Piccolo and moves on for whom he believes he's looking for, Kakarot, he actually runs into Krillin. And then Krillin's level, if you recall, Goku's level was at a 4, and Piccolo's was a 3.
What? Fantasy. He was at a 10 when he was a kid.
Okay, never mind. Was it 300?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
It was
right.
300 and then 304.
That sounds right.
Something like that. They were so close, Piccolo and Goku. But Goku was just a tad bit above him. However, Raditz this time is looking through the scouter, and he realizes that there's a power that's about 310. It's a few numbers higher than Piccolo's. And he goes, "Ah, that must be Kakarot." So then he flies that way and runs into Krillin. And he goes, "Kakarot?" And then Krillin's like, "Pretty close. My name starts with a K, actually, but it's Krillin." And then Raditz says, "Well, you look much different than I would have thought you turned out. In fact, I thought that Saiyan's hair wasn't supposed to change. I don't know what's going on anymore, but you must be Kakarot because of your power level." And Krillin replies with, "No, once again, I'm definitely not Kakarot, but you look like an evil guy, so what's the deal with you? I have no time to waste with you." And then as Raditz charges up a double Sunday blast for Krillin, Krillin instantly charges a Kamehameha wave. The two blasts emerge and a big explosion occurs. Raditz obviously is thrown off completely as to why this short bald guy, who should be an earthling, is able to defend his blast with his own like that. So Raditz then thinks to himself, "These earthlings have so far potential. I don't know what's going on here." And then Krillin instantly thinks to himself, "This guy is no joke. I just became a Saiyan like Goku, and this guy is easily on my level. He you might be a Saiyan too. So these two then proceed to fight. After a long battle of stalemate ends and explosions.
Oh, wasn't Raditz at like 1200 or something? His power level was like 1200.
Is it?
Yeah, and then when Gohan flew out of the pod, he's like, 600? 700? 800? What's going on here? The scouter's broken. And he was 1200. I'm pretty sure y'all.
Raditz was 1200?
Yeah, Kakarot was absolutely.
And Goku and Piccolo just destroyed him that easily?
They didn't destroy him. The only way they were able to do it was to grab his tail.
Yeah.
And then they would have gotten him if Goku didn't let go of the tail. And then the full Nelson thing, he was just able to hold on to him long enough.
Yeah, Goku ends up grabbing him with his arms.
Yeah.
Does the wrestling move on.
To go all the way through on a lightning round, you gotta go way faster.
Oh man, I don't even know what more to say, y'all.
Let's see. So Krillin does his best that he can against Raditz, and then eventually Goku comes. They don't make it to the Kamehameha house. They're having a pretty... So Goku senses it, and he flies over to check it out. And he's like, whoa, what's going on here? And then he's like, oh, you're Kakarot. I don't know what's going on. Why is this Earthling here stronger than you, Kakarot? And then Goku's like, Krillin? Stronger than me? How do you know that? He's like, I got this scouter. And then Goku's like, well, I'm not really sure how that works. I've been training as hard as I can. And last time I knew, I was stronger than Krillin. But, alright. And then Goku tries to fight Raditz instantly. Instantly gets beaten. And then Raditz tells of his plan to take Kakarot away. And if he doesn't want to come, he's just going to blow up the planet and all that stuff. Raditz finds out he married an Earthling woman, and he's just talking smack. And then the same thing happens. He goes and waits at his pod for Goku, and he takes Krillin with him this time, because Krillin's all beaten up. He doesn't take Gohan, but Goku still wants to save Krillin, so eventually he recruits Piccolo, and they really got no... They're not going to let Raditz blow up the Earth or whatever, so they have no choice but to go and fight him. So they go to the pod, and they start fighting Raditz, and at that time, it's about a day later, Krillin is, you know, he's come to, he actually got a Zenkai boost from Raditz beating the living crud out of him, and Krillin is sitting there, he's all like, he's in the pod and stuff, and then he's just watching the fight, and Goku and Piccolo start getting completely overwhelmed, and he just sees his friends in pain, and he's like, I have to pay Goku back for all the stuff he's done for me. I remember when I got killed, and then Goku was so angry, and he fought really hard to win against... Who killed him again? In Dragon Ball?
One of Piccolo's henchmen.
Yeah. He's like, when one of Piccolo's henchmen killed me, Goku was so mad, he fought so hard and beat them. He overcame that immense challenge, and he resurrected me. I gotta do the same thing for Goku, somehow, anyhow. And then Krillin gets the ultimate rage boost, just like little Gohan did. He busts out of the pod and smashes Raditz in the stomach, exactly as Gohan did. If not enough to beat Raditz, but it knocks the wind out of him, and he goes over and helps Piccolo and Goku. They kind of regroup a little bit. And Goku's like, what's going on, Krillin? That was crazy. I can't believe you just did that. And then Krillin's like, I got a long story to tell you, but for now, let's try to beat him. And so they come up with a tactic. Goku and Krillin get on both sides of Raditz. They're both charging up a Kamehameha. And then Raditz basically dodges it, and Piccolo is already above him. Piccolo tries to hit him. He hits Piccolo. And then as he goes down, Krillin's already on the ground waiting for Raditz, and then he kicks Raditz, but then all of a sudden, Goku's hand pops out of the dirt. Goku buried himself, and he grabbed Raditz's tail, and he's holding on to that tail for dear life. And then, while he's doing that, Krillin comes over and grabs right its tail, and he says, "Goku, let me hold his tail. This is your blood and flesh brother. I know you too well, Goku. He might try to talk some dirty trick or whatever and make you let go of his tail." So Goku hands it over to Krillin. Krillin's holding the tail, and he is not going to let Raditz go. And Raditz is trying to talk to Goku and make him get Krillin to let go of his tail and all that stuff, but it's not working. So eventually what they do is, what do they do? I guess they just hold his tail and beat the living crud out of Raditz until he blacks out, and then they tie him up and stuff, and they take him to Bulma's place, and Bulma puts him in under some kind of lock and chain thing, so he can't do anything. And he tells them about the Saiyan threat that's coming, so they start to train and prepare for that. Well, as they're training, Krillin tells Goku everything, and Piccolo, and Goku's like, okay, that's kind of weird. Well, at least now I know I'm a Saiyan. I can't believe you knew that before me, Krillin. And Krillin's like, yeah, well, I'm a Saiyan too, and that gives me more motivation to train. So they're training super hard, preparing for Nappa and Vegeta's arrival. Goku doesn't go to King Kai's anymore because he didn't die. But they're training really hard, and now Krillin is another Saiyan. So Goku has a really good training partner, and they're working on their techniques and whatnot. And eventually, Nappa and Vegeta show up. How would this fight go? Well, since Krillin's a Saiyan and Goku's a Saiyan, and they were fighting pretty hard, they were able to give each other Zenkai boosts and whatnot, and they had a fair amount of Senzu beans, so they did get stronger. They wanted to be... Their goal was to get at least as strong as Raditz, so I'm gonna keep going. And, they were able to get a little bit stronger than Raditz. It's not enough for Vegeta and Nappa, though. So Vegeta and Nappa come, and everyone gathers the Dragon Balls beforehand because they're just not prepared for that, for the threat, if Raditz was telling the truth that two stronger Saiyans were coming. And so while they're getting ready to make a wish from Shenron, and Vegeta and Nappa come, they're blowing up the city, and so everyone knows they arrived. And then Goku and Krillin go over there, and they got no choice but to try to fight. They are at least going to try to fight when they have all their energy. They got some Senzu Bean backups, so, well, they're fighting. A couple other people, Tien and them, are going to summon Shenron. Take it from there.
What are they summoning Shenron for?
Backup plan.
Backup plan.
Yeah. They don't think they can beat Nappa and Raditz if Raditz was telling... Nappa and Vegeta. If Raditz was telling the truth, then they're that strong.
The backup plan is that they ask Shenron for more secrets in the Saiyan race. And Shenron reveals to them this power of the Super Saiyan. And Goku and Krillin instantly think that they can reach that level together. So then they train to the limit so that they can reach this power. However, it's to no avail. They don't reach this power, and they have to go into the battle anyway.
Oh, that's fine.
Goku and Krillin enter the battle with Nappa and Vegeta, and they both go one-on-one. Nappa takes Krillin, Vegeta takes Goku. In this story, Goku is inferior to Vegeta. Goku didn't get as strong because he didn't have the guidance of King Kai training him. Krillin, however, can defeat Nappa. Now, because Vegeta is far stronger than Goku, he pushes Goku to the limit, and then when Goku is wounded on the ground, he goes for Krillin. After killing Nappa for Krillin, because Krillin couldn't do it, couldn't bring himself to do it, Vegeta then says to Krillin, "I don't care about my comrades, and I don't care about you either. All I care about is getting immortality. So after he throws Nappa into the air and kills him, he then goes for Krillin. Krillin is way too worn out to go on. He just defeated Nappa and spared his life in doing so. And that took so much out of him. Vegeta then just unleashes even more power than he did on Nappa on Krillin, having no sympathy for him at all. He goes for Krillin and wails on him a ton of times, throws him into the air, beats him around like a rag doll, and then blasts him with his Gallic gun. At this, Goku's rage just goes out the window. I mean, he goes through the roof. He had never seen his friend die like this before, and never seen so much bloodshed in his life. Goku then is able to gather the strength to then burst into Super Saiyan.
Realizing it's the second time Krillin's died, and he won't be able to be wished back with Earth's Dragon Balls.
Yep. So at this, now, mind you, Goku and Vegeta had fought a long time, and Vegeta was worn out too, just not to these extremes. Once Vegeta sees Goku in this new form, he instantly knows exactly what it is, and he returns to his pod and says, "Kakarot, we'll meet again one day, but I can't fight you in this level. You've reached a level that I've been trying to attain my whole life, and there's no way I could go against you. But I will reach it, and we will fight again." And Vegeta cowardly takes off, Goku in his new form.
Yeah, Goku would definitely let him leave, because now he's like, I can handle him if he comes back with this new form. Even though he's insanely angry, he probably did have like a moral conflict, wondering if he should finish Vegeta right there. So we'll leave it there for that one. If you guys enjoyed it, let me know. I can add pictures to it and we can make another part. Let's see. So, today is heavy chest and triceps. I'm gonna be working out. I hope you guys are living strong and I hope you're getting motivated by Dragon Ball and whatever else you're doing in your life. Let it motivate you. If what you're watching and what you're doing isn't giving you energy to get out and do what you love or do what you think is right, then you need to fill your life with different things. So yeah, I'm gonna give my all on my bench today. I've overcome so many obstacles. My bench press, my max bench press is now over 300 pounds and it feels great. It started out with a minor spirit of rivalry, but now it ends just like Goku and Krillin. We've both become Saiyan. That is, having a bench press over 300 pounds. And now we're just seeing how far we can go individually. And we're giving each other tips and supporting each other. And that's how you all should be too. Have some rivalry. Don't let it go too far. And remember to support the people supporting you. And be nice to everyone, y'all. Even murderers support the people supporting them usually, so you gotta do a little bit more than them. Alright guys, be nice to yourselves and be nice to others. Keep training, have a good day, and let me know any other topics you want to hear discussed. I do have a list of a bunch of cool good topics to discuss about exercise and health, but I left the list at home, and yeah, so you got what you got today, I hope. You found something that you personally enjoyed in this podcast. Thank you so much. See ya.